All right, welcome everyone. My name is Lisa Pellerine. I am the Director of Enrollment Management here at Chapel Hill Chauncey Hall School. This is my 19th year at CHCH in this position. And tonight we are offering a webinar to really speak about what it's like to transfer from a public school to an independent school and just providing some perspective on that. This evening we have some of our current students, actually one graduating senior, a current parent, and another parent will be joining us in just a little bit. But really, I want to give them all the opportunity to share their stories, and hopefully that will resonate with some of you joining us this evening. We will be utilizing the chat button. So for those families who have any questions, please feel free to put in your questions in the chat, and then I will ask our panelists to answer your questions. So without further ado, I'm gonna have everyone go around and introduce themselves, and then we'll get started. So I'm actually gonna be starting with our parent, Diane Gardner.
Hi, everybody. My name is Diane Gardner, and I am the parent of a rising senior who's been at Chapel Hill Chauncey Hall for a year and a half. She transferred mid-year of her sophomore year from public school.
Okay, great. All right, next up, I'm gonna have Sophia go next.
Hi, I'm Sophia Blair Golden. I'm a graduated senior from Wayland, Massachusetts. I transferred my sophomore year, and I was a girls varsity soccer captain. I did girls basketball and lacrosse, National Honor Society, student government, and I was a student tour guide leader.
Great. Thank you, Sophia. Next up, we have Bridget Traub.
Hi, I'm Bridget. I'm from Medfield, Massachusetts. I'm the leader of the GSA, a member of SOCA, a member of NHS, and I do theater. I started as a freshman, and I'm a rising junior.
Great, thank you, Bridget. Next is Sammy.
Hi, I'm Sammy. I'm from Sudbury, and I'm gonna be a rising sophomore. I have done volleyball, basketball, and theater, and I started as a freshman. Great,
thank you. Next, we have Christina.
Hi, everyone. I'm Christina Leonelli. I'm the Assistant Director of Admissions and International Student Coordinator at CHCH. I'm also a dorm parent. I live on campus for the past 5 years, and this is my sixth year at Chapel Hill Chauncey Hall School.
Great. Thank you, Christina. Last but not least, we have Caroline Finnemore.
Hi, I'm Caroline Finnemore. I actually graduated from CHCH in 2013. I am the admissions officer, and I have been here at CHCH as a staff member for 3 years now.
Great, thank you, Caroline. Okay, so I just wanna start by having everyone just talk about their experience. Maybe if we wanna start with Diane, just talking about, what kind of sparked you to look at independent schools, and kind of what brought you to CHCH, and I guess we'll start with there, kind of what sparked that interest in looking at other options, and then we can kind of go into the experience.
Sure. I first want to say that I do have a barking dog, so if I suddenly go on mute, that's why. My daughter had gone through the Arlington Public Schools the whole time, and she had been at the high school, and it really became clear that it was just not a good fit for her. It was almost like a square peg round hole situation. And my colleague at work had, her daughter had transferred to CHCH, and they just spoke so glowingly about it. And one day I just picked up the phone and called and talked to Caroline, and she said, "Are you thinking mid-year?" And I said, "I am now." So that was kind of how it happened. It all happened very quickly and seamlessly. We didn't look at any other schools. The minute my daughter Lulu stepped onto the campus, she was like, "I'm in," and it's been a great situation for her and for us. Excuse me.
No worries. Thank you, Diane. Sophia, if you want to talk about your experience, you came in as a sophomore, so can you talk a little bit about, your freshman year of high school and kind of what brought you to CHCH?
So I decided to transfer because being from a bigger public school, I felt that like in class, it was very hard to find one-on-one time with my teachers. My school schedule, like daily schedule, was very jam-packed. So I felt like during class, I wasn't really learning much. I was just focusing on getting through the day. And when I found out about skills and academic support, which is more like one-on-one help for 75 minutes each class block, I thought that that was really helpful. So for me, it was just like the smaller class sizes and like having many more opportunities for that like one-on-one support with teachers.
Okay, great. Thank you, Sophia. Bridget, do you mind talking about your experience and kind of what brought you to look at other options? And if you can also mention too, if you look at other schools, what kind of stood out to you about CHCH?
Oh, yeah. I went to the same public school up until eighth grade. It was a really bad fit, and that was clear pretty much immediately. But my parents both went to public school until eighth grade, or my mom went until ninth, and then they switched to different private schools. So they always knew that was an option. And they started looking, I think, when I was in fourth or fifth grade, because they knew that it was a really bad place. They thought I'd be able to just survive long enough to go to public high school. It became clear when I was in middle school that that wasn't actually the case, but I think my mom talked to people at CHCH, which was already our clear main school that we wanted to apply at. I applied for others just in case I didn't get in, but we were fairly sure that I would. Not to seem like I have an overblown sense of my own importance. But it was a really bad place for me at Medfield. It was just similarly square peg, round hole. And I have some learning differences, which made it much worse as well. Sorry, what were the other questions that you had? I forgot already.
Sorry. Nope, that was perfect. Yep. And we'll kind of get into it a little bit more after this.
Okay.
That
was perfect. Yeah.
Thanks, Bridget.
I just knew that Chapel Hill taught the thing, the whole teach the way students learn, immediately became a big part of, that was really what I needed. And I needed a smaller class size to thrive. And Medfield was a bit, as a neurodivergent queer kid, it wasn't particularly friendly to me. So coming to a more accepting school was also a very big thing. And the thing that got me through middle school was just focusing on the fact that when I got old enough to apply to Chapel Hill, I would. And the only thing that got me through was knowing that I could apply. Mm-hmm. I sort of held it up as this big shining light at the end of the tunnel kind of a thing. Mm-hmm. And it's just what got me through without losing my mind. Yeah.
Thank you, Bridget. Sammy, do you want to talk about your experience from your high school and then transferring?
Yeah, so I went to Sudbury Elementary School like up until eighth grade. And I was pretty sure that I was gonna go to like public high school until like the end of June. And my mom was talking to some of her friends and we were like, oh, try CHCH, it might be a good fit because my classes were really big. It was like 25 kids per class. I never felt like I could like speak up in class because I just was, there were just so many kids. So coming here and having like smaller classes, being able to like be close with like your teachers and being able to like talk to them about different like needs that you have, like really helped me because I did not really know my teachers very well in public school. And coming here and having like such a more like structured like schedule, and I had like so many classes each day, every class every day. And that was just, it was just very overwhelming. And coming here, it was like really, it was like a good start to like going to high school. And my biggest thing is small classes. Like I think that helped me like the most out of everything.
Great. Thank you, Sammy. Hi, Sharon. Welcome. Thank you for helping tonight. If you want to take a moment to introduce yourself, and then we were just going around just talking about, you know, what brought you to CHCH, kind of what was the backstory to kind of leading you to go through the process of looking at independent schools, and kind of what stood out to you about CHCH.
Sure. Hi, everyone. I'm Sharon Yamamoto. I'm sorry to be a little bit late, but happy that I'm here now. I am the parent of the mother of two girls who just finished ninth grade. So we did come from the Winchester School District, and they had been in public school their entire lives until we applied to high school. The reason I was looking for them, and they were very interested in going to a smaller school. I was very happy with the school district up until the end of eighth grade, but I felt like the high school was a bit big, a lot of pressure that I didn't think they needed. And we were really looking for something smaller and more hands-on, and, you know, the attention that we get from a smaller school. And CHCH was such a great fit. Even from the open house, you could see that one of my daughters needed a little extra help with the executive functioning skills. So the SAS was definitely a huge draw. But really, just from the interview, we felt very welcomed, and, you know, the girls have different personalities, but it seemed like a school that would fit both of them, and that was really important. But definitely the size of the school, the campus, they loved, you know, it's beautiful, so they that was definitely a huge plus for them, and just feeling like they had a voice in the environment was the reason why we chose CHCH.
Great, thank you. And SAS has been mentioned a few times, so I just want to quickly fill you in on what that stands for and what that means. So the SAS program is a skills and academic support program, and it's part of, you know, when we're going through the application process and reading files, it's something that the admissions committee would determine whether or not a student has the SAS program. And so all of our courses, all of the core subjects meet 3 times a week for 75 minutes. I think Sophia mentioned, you know, she had every class every day in public school. It was just so overwhelming. So here it is more like a college schedule where you know, all your classes meet 3 times a week, including the SAS class. So so for ninth grade, the average class sizes are about 8 to 10. The upper classes are about 12 to 14. So they do grow a little bit, but not too big compared to those big public school numbers. And but the SAS program, it's a 4-to-1 student teacher ratio. And that's really where the SAS teachers are part of grade level teams. So they're aware of curriculum, they're aware of homework assignments, and they're really there to work with students, you know, to work on skill building. So Sharon mentioned, you know, executive function, learning how to take notes in class, learning how to advocate, learning study techniques. Sophia, do you want to talk a little bit about kind of how you used SAS and how that worked out for you?
Yeah, so I took SAS only my sophomore year. And for me, the one, like, two skills that I was focusing on the most were like time management, because I'm a procrastinator, and like essay writing, and kind of like blocking out all my paragraphs, because that's something that I really struggle with. So what my SAS teacher liked to do was spend like the first half of class teaching like a little like mini lesson about that topic. And then the second half of class, I would like apply that lesson that I just learned to my current work. So instead of being given more work for that SAS class, it's time to like get to know yourself as a learner and learn skills to help you like manage your work better. And then you also get time to finish that work. So you have less when you go home.
Great, thank you, Sophia. I just want to take a moment to welcome Josh Bubar to our webinar tonight. Thank you for joining us, Josh. If you want to introduce yourself, and then Josh, actually, I asked Josh to join us just to give kind of a brief overview and presentation of CHCH, just to talk about our different programs. And then I thought that might spark some questions for, excuse me, families, and then having our panelists speak to that. So, sorry. Josh, do you want to introduce yourself?
Hi, everybody. Sorry, I was just making sure I wasn't on mute. After 15 months, I still lose that a little bit. It's nice to see everybody tonight. My name is Josh Bubar. I'm the assistant head of school here at Chapel Hill Chauncey Hall, which really means that every piece of the student experience is something that I have a hand in. I just completed my 20th school year here. I've done a little bit of everything. I've taught history, I've taught English, I've taught SAS, I've coached a bunch of different sports. I've lived in both the boys' dorm and the girls' dorm. I think about the only thing I haven't done is be involved with the theater program, which is probably for the best for the theater program. I love this place. I can't imagine working anywhere else. I know Lisa asked me to talk about our programs, but I think the most important thing to me is our kids. I've worked with adolescents my entire career. I work with, been here for 20 years, three other schools prior to that. And I've coached a number of different levels of basketball and baseball and adolescents. And I would say, hands down, we have the kindest kids that you will ever meet. It's an incredibly welcoming community. It's a community where all sorts of different kids are really accepted for who they are and who they might become. And I think both our kids and our parents find that incredibly refreshing in many ways, depending on where they're coming from. So programmatically, we do a lot of great things. I heard Sophia talking a little bit about SAS. I think SAS is one of the signature programs for us. It's something that probably 90% of our students engage in at some point during their Chapel Hill Chauncey Hall career. It really is very much a foundational program in terms of developing academic skills, developing executive function skills. And I think the best part about it is how seamless the integration is with the content area teachers. I think one of the things you find in public school, certainly, my children are in public school right now. My son was on an IEP and a 504. And one of the things I found is that often the special ed teachers, who are kind of the case managers, for lack of a better word, for those students, are often at odds with the content area teachers. They really want what's best for the kid, and the content area teachers are always bumping up against that. And, well, we have to do things this way. And it really, that's not the dynamic here. In fact, our SAS teachers, some of the best lessons that I've learned as a teacher during my career here have come from our SAS teachers, have come from their experience. For example, looking at one of my assignment sheets and having worked through it with a student and just being able to come to me and say, hey, Josh, this is a great assignment. It has lots of potential for differentiation, lots of different ways kids can show you what they know. But I think if you wrote it this way, the students would really begin to understand that and see all the possibilities. I think if you framed it this way, if you were able to kind of organize it this way, and that's invaluable for me as a teacher, and it's invaluable for all of our faculty, because it allows us to do what we want to do, which is enable kids to learn, enable kids to grow, enable them to show us what they know how to do and where they need to develop further. Because in the end, as a college prep school, our students, and I heard Sophia say this, they need to learn how they approach learning and learning tasks. And everybody approaches them differently. Bridget and Sophia, probably, they're both talented writers. My guess is they don't approach the task of writing the same. And that's okay. And the key here is learning how best that you do that. The other piece programmatically that I think sets us apart from many public schools is what I would call kind of the tightness of communication. And so all of our grades we have core teachers in each grade, and they're part of a grade level team. And that team meets on a regular basis, both to discuss grade level programming, but also just to discuss student progress. And so there's very, very little opportunity for students to slip through the cracks. We're really involved in students' lives. We know what's going on with them typically. And you're also going to be the beneficiary as parents and as students of weekly progress notes. So those are notes that all of our teachers write up for all of their students. They go out typically weekly. We'll take certain weeks over the course of the trimester off. And they go first to students on Tuesday morning. Students will see those. They'll meet with their academic advisor to talk about them. And then they go out to parents. They get published to parents on Wednesdays, which gives students an opportunity to, if there are any concerns in those progress notes, maybe a missing piece of work or a little note about, oh, you should do your quiz corrections. It gives the students an opportunity to kind of make sure that stuff is taken care of, make sure they have a plan, so that then when they go home to talk to their parents about it, it's like, there's no surprises. And it's, yeah, I took care of that. That's all done. Or I made an appointment to go see my teacher during office hours on Thursday where I'm going to take care of it. And I think that tight communication is also something that for many of our parents and families coming from public school, they find incredibly valuable because that's something that has been missing in their experience. And I think last, you know, it's just this general sense that we are really truly student-centered. We really want to get to know every single kid and kind of what makes them tick. I often get the question in some of these, you know, who's a student, who's not a good fit at Chapel Hill Chauncey Hall, right? Because as parents and as students, you're anxious. You're like, oh, is this the right place for my child? Is this the right place for me? And often I think one of the answers I have is if your child is not interested, your student isn't interested in getting to know adults and being known by adults, Chapel Hill is a tough place to be. And I think our students would agree. You know, our adults, they want to know kids. They want to dig in with them and help them grow. And I think our most successful students are the ones who let adults be part of their lives and be mentors for them. And they accept that mentoring and they grow from it. So those are the big pieces of our program that I think really pertain to the public to private piece. Lisa, I don't know if there was something else you wanted me to cover.
Yeah, no, I would definitely agree with everything you said. And I think another thing I often hear and when I'm interviewing families and meeting with students is that they no longer have the interest in wanting to do co-curriculars or joining a club or being part of the athletic program or the arts program because it's just too competitive in a big public school, or they just don't have time after school because, you know, they're so far behind in their work that then they have to have a tutor or just, you know, it takes them longer to do their schoolwork and, you know, they just can't handle it all. So it's just sad to me that, you know, they're not able to continue to do those things that they love or just be part of something. So I think something that we do really well is that you're part of the community, you are, you know, asked to do participate all three trimesters in a co-curricular after school. You have choices between the performing arts or the athletic program. We have both JV and varsity sports. So for those students who are extremely talented, can continue to be challenged in that way. But for students who have never played a sport, they can be part of that. If, you know, I know Bridget's actively involved in our performing arts program, and just, you know, there's a place for everyone, which I think is nice. Do you students want to talk a little bit about that and kind of maybe how that was a game changer for you or different now while you are or were at the school, Sophia? So Sammy or Bridget or Sophia, do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Something I was super worried about when I was applying was in every school I go to, they'd say, so you have to do two trimesters of sports. You can do some theater too. That's cool. But what I liked about CHCH is that I could do both of my team sports as theater because I am not an athletic person. I'm very unathletic. I hated gym class. I was the one who was hiding in the back trying not to get hit by the dodgeballs. The thing that I really loved was that I didn't have to do something I was uncomfortable with. I could just do theater and it would be counted as both of my team sports. Cause it really is a team effort putting a production on. And if your kid isn't the on stage kind of person, you can do both theater tech, which I know some of my friends have done. It's really good that even if you are super unathletic like me, you can get your team requirements by doing theater.
That's a great point. Thanks.
And Miss Lacoste is an amazing director and Miss Epstein is an amazing music director and the entire theater program is super welcoming and really nice. Mm-hmm. And really energetic.
That our faculty and staff are the coaches or program leaders. So you also get to develop those relationships outside of the classroom as well. And, you know, maybe, you know, your sophomore English teacher is your basketball coach before you even have English. So it's kind of cool to develop that relationship before that as well. Sammy, for you, just being new to the school, I know this year was a little bit different with COVID and having it as an, you know, optional after school. Did you, you know, find that that was helpful for you to be part of that program? And did you find a difference?
Yeah, I think that it was extremely helpful. like to meet like new kids, to meet like other teachers, but also to get like closer with kids too. Mm-hmm. I never thought of myself as like a like musical type person, but so I did like volleyball and basketball like fall and winter, and then me and my friends were like, let's try theater, and we loved it and we had a great time, and we're probably gonna do theater every year. And I think that was also really nice because it was super welcoming for us who like we had never done it before, and we like had a great time. We met so many new kids who like weren't in our grades, became like really close with different teachers who we don't have that we might have like in like higher grades. So I think that it was like really, really amazing for me to like meet new kids and like meet new teachers, but then also do something that I like really enjoy while like being with them.
Great, thank you, Sammy. Sophia, do you have anything you'd like to add?
Yeah, I have a lot to say about the athletics program, because like, I don't know, like to me, like all of like the sports teams that I were on were like my favorite parts of being at Chapel Hill. I honestly think that preseason soccer was like where I made all of my friends. And that was like my first 2 days at school. But I've like played competitive soccer like my whole life. And so I feel like being on that team, like although we are a smaller school, the coaches do a very good job of like pushing the kids that have more experience while also teaching them how to lead the younger students who might not have as much experience. But then I also played basketball and lacrosse, which I had never done before, never even thought about doing. And I honestly really liked it. My two coaches for those sports were very good about like helping me one-on-one if I needed help. And no one on the team really expected me to like be the best or like know what I was doing. Everyone's very welcoming to you if you're like new to the sport or new to theater, or honestly any activity on campus. Like I've never been pushed away because I don't know what I'm doing. So like the inclusiveness is just like, it was beyond helpful for me transferring sophomore year.
Great, thank you. Diane or Sharon, as parents, anything else you would want to add to this topic or share?
Do you have anything? I could talk about a little bit. Yeah, my daughter. So I want to say that I also have twins, and one of them stayed at the public high school because it was a great fit for her. But Lulu had never found a sport that she really loved, and she had always kind of wanted to play soccer, and then she sort of wanted to play lacrosse, and she played both this year and she absolutely loved them. I have to admit, I don't know what it's going to be like next year when you actually have games, but she looks at her, she thinks of herself differently because she's part of this team, and she loved it. She loved both of them. So that's all I can say.
And I would just echo
thank
that.
Thank you,
actually.
Sophie.
I would just echo that because the girls are the same. They tried cross country this year. They've never done it before. And it's really the team, because they didn't have any meets this year, but the team, they couldn't stop talking about, you know, the people on the team and the coach. They just had such a wonderful time. So they'll continue that because of the positive team experience.
I'd love to hear too from both parents and students, you know, now that you've been on this journey with us and just have seen the difference between public school to independent school. Sammy, if you could kind of reflect back, right, when, like from the day you and I met for your interview and where you are now, just finishing up your first year, what do you see like as, like just kind of as a reflection, what's the biggest change you've seen in yourself over the past year?
For me, definitely like participating more in everything. So like participating more in sports, raising my hand more in class, like speaking up more in class, like everything like that. I always was like very, I'd be like the type of person that would want to sit in the back, like never talk, just be there to get it over with. And now like I enjoy my classes. Like I love seeing my teachers and stuff like that. And also sports. Like I had always been, I always have done sports, but I never had like the best coaches. And like, I was pretty nervous to do sports, but this year, like, I think it was a really good introduction. Again, cause I didn't do sports in eighth grade because like just things were so bad. So coming here and it was just like everything was just like so welcoming, and I was just able to participate in a lot more and like grow a lot. And I'm just like really excited to get back like in the fall to do sports, see my friends, see my teachers, and start 10th grade.
Wow, that's impressive. I'm sure like I remember when I was younger, I was not thinking about going back to school when school just ended. So that's really refreshing to hear that, Sammy. How about for you, Bridget? Anything you'd like to kind of share as like kind of your biggest transition?
There was this one time I was walking up the steps into Wilkins. That's one of the buildings where most of the upperclassmen and sophomore classes are. And it just hit me that I was like on CHCH campus. I was at CHCH. I wasn't in Medfield. I wasn't struggling anymore. Like I was free. Getting onto campus for the first time and not being at Medfield, it was really just a breath of fresh air. Cause I wasn't around the people who I'd known since kindergarten, who all knew how to make me tick, the ways to bully me, to get me to respond. I wasn't surrounded by people who had treated me like I was inferior for 10 years. And it was like, oh, it's a new place. It's a new start. I can be myself without who I've been for the last 10 years that everyone got to know. So they know how to use it against me. No one knows how to use anything against me here. I can't be bullied here. I won't be bullied here. I haven't been bullied here. I got bullied. I started getting bullied when I was, I don't know, 4 at preschool. And like, no one's ever been mean to me here. And it's just like, I thought that was going to be my life. And I'm still in shock that it's not. And it's, most people don't get to shed the skin of who they were as a child until they go off to college. And I mean, I'm still a child, but I mean, a younger child, but I got to get rid of her, who I was then, that all of that unhealthy mess, I got to get rid of it at 14. And now I'm here and I'm sitting in the summer willingly going to a school meeting. Like, it's extraordinary. And I'm just so, it hits me every so often how glad I am that I'm still here and that I'm still alive and thriving. It's just, it's really, there's no words for it really.
Thank you, Bridget. That's really sweet. Thank you for being so authentic and sharing that. Sophia is going to college next year. Do you want to talk about where you're going to school and what you're maybe majoring in and kind of, you know, what you see as your biggest change over the past 3 years?
Yeah, so I'm going to Roger Williams. I'm committed to their honors program. And for me, I think my biggest takeaway has honestly been all of the opportunities that I've been given through CHCH. One I will talk about actually is the independent study I did this year with Miss Leonelli. So I'm planning to major in business, and I didn't really know like what business focus I wanted to do. But I've always been very interested in like admissions and kind of like the whole enrollment process. So this year I worked with Miss Palerine, Miss Leonelli, and Miss Finnemore actually in the admissions office. And we came up with a class that kind of taught me about like enrollment management, kind of like marketing stuff, social media, stuff like that. And I feel much more prepared going into my business major from learning that. I would also just say in terms of academics, I had never even like like dreamed of being in an honors program, because freshman year, I just did not have the grades that were going to like lead me to that. But coming to Chapel Hill with SAS and the smaller classes, office hours, all of like that individual help time, I have like straight A's in all my classes, and like I was given the opportunity to be a part of the honors program. And I don't think like in being at a public school, I would have had that same opportunity.
Lisa, can I just, I know we have a question, but I'd just like to wait, because I think Sophia is a great example of how, of another piece of our program, which is our college counseling program. And a great example of finding right fit. So Sophia is a much better student than she is letting on, or has grown into being a much better student perhaps than she is currently letting on. And was in fact admitted to, you know, a number of very selective schools, and really had a lot of great choices, and chose this honors program at Roger Williams because she did a lot of digging and realized it was the right fit place for her. And I think that's at the core of that college process for us. You know, we have a full-time dedicated college counselor who works with all of our senior class, starts with them kind of when they're juniors in the winter of their junior year, a little bit earlier with some families who want to kind of get that process, the ball rolling a little bit earlier. And I think across the board, I can't think of a family who has walked away from that process in the last 5 years unhappy with the array of choices that their child had when it came time to move on to college. Sophia, do you have your hand up?
Just to add to what Mr. Bubar was saying, Ms. Fink doesn't just help you in getting into college. She also is there for you if you want to transfer, if you need any help like that after college. I've seen her help like past graduate students. So it's just nice to know that like you always have that resource, and that goes for all of the other teachers. Like I graduated like 2 weeks ago and I'm still talking to a lot of my teachers just about life. So like having those like, I would say lifelong relationships, and like being able to connect with like my teachers on like a friend level is like really nice to have.
Great, thank you. So there was a question in the chat. Let me see, what are some reasons that you do not accept applicants at CHCH? So, you know, one of the big things I would say is if we're just not the right fit academically for a student, if they have academic needs beyond what our Skills and Academic Support Program would offer, we often will take a look at neuropsych testing. So if a student is on an IEP in public school and has testing that's within 3 years old, we will use that instead of the SSAT, which is the secondary school assessment test. And, you know, oftentimes we'll work with our director of the SAS program and take a look at the testing before a family goes through the process, just to say, you know, if this makes sense, I think you should, you know, these are some of our concerns, but let's dig a little bit more and go through the application process. Or sometimes it is, you know, pretty evident from that testing that it's beyond a student that the profile of what we could support. Second, I would say, you know, something that Josh referred to earlier, that, you know, if students aren't able to really develop relationships with the adults in their life, and I know sometimes that's, you know, we want to make sure the potential is there. I know oftentimes when students are in public school, they feel like they don't even know how to do that, for example, but I think that's something we really try to dig for in the admissions process when we're doing the interview or reading recommendations. Also, our schedule is different. It's not that, like, you just show up to school and can go home. Like public school, we do require you to be part of that co-curricular program. And so sometimes students just, you know, don't want to be a part of that, right? They just want to focus on academics and that's it. So I would say really, it's about finding the best fit school, just like we talked about with the college process. For us, it has to be both ways, that, you know, you have to be the right fit for us, but also, sorry, child's running in the background, but also that it feels right for you. I think, you know, Diane, you might've said when Lulu came to campus, she just immediately felt that comfort level and felt connected and was the right fit. For some students, they don't feel that, and that's okay. You know, we want to make sure that, you know, this is a journey and students are able to take advantage of all that we have to offer. But there needs to feel that connectedness as well. So I hope I answered your question, Barbara. Do all students go to college post-graduation? Do you have a culture where non-college options are welcomed? Josh, do you want to answer that?
Yeah, I'll talk about that a little bit. So one of our graduation requirements is that all of our students will apply to college. So they go through the college application process. All of our students kind of explore what that looks like, and they find a place, and we do have 100% college acceptance. What that means can be fairly broad. We certainly do have some students for whom a two-year community college is their next step when they leave us. We do have students who take a gap year. Typically, I'd say 10% of the class in any given year. And we also do have, you know, so for example, we had a senior this year who was weighing his options between enlisting in the military, putting off college for a couple of years, and then enrolling after having spent some time in the military. He ended up choosing to go to college. He's going to be in the ROTC program down at Assumption. So it's certainly part of the conversation we have with kids, but we do, as a college prep school, have them go through the college process so that they have that option open to them. And I'd say in the end, the vast majority of our students are enrolling in college post-graduation.
Great, thank you, Josh. The next question, how many hours does a day student usually stay on campus, and approximately how many hours of homework do your lower level students usually take home? Josh, you wanna answer the homework question, and then I can have the students talk about kind of.
Well, I tell you what, can we go the other way? Cause I'd be as a ninth grader and a sophomore would say about the how much homework question. So our class day starts at 8, 4 days a week, and then it starts at 9 on Wednesdays. And then with co-curriculars, it can extend, if you're an athlete and you have a game, you're going until about, you might go until 5:30, 6 o'clock, Sophia, right? For a soccer game, 5:30 probably, right? If you are in the play and it's show week, Bridget, you're there fairly late because the curtain will go up on a Thursday at 7. And so you might be there till 9. But in a more typical day, you're there till 4:30, 5 o'clock. And then I think the homework question is a great one. I would love to hear Sammy, Bridget. I mean, this is a small sample of two, but I'd love to hear what you two think.
I may not be indicative of the general population. I'm a fairly fast worker. When I had SAS last year, I very rarely brought home homework. I was generally able to finish 90 to 100% of my work in freshman year, either by utilizing SAS and not spending it goofing off with friends, which of course is a great opportunity. I just so happen to be a person who likes doing homework, which is, I'm very strange right now. This year I generally had 30 minutes, 45, unless I had an essay, which is maybe once or twice per trimester. With a few exceptions, and accepting the final week of each trimester, it was very manageable. And that's saying something because I live about 45 minutes away from campus.
And Sammy, do you want to talk about it a little?
Yeah, so for me, I did SAS this past year, and it was very helpful for me with like homework wise, but also like study skills. And I rarely brought home homework as well. Mostly like essays, sometimes like I would only have like a few each trimester, and then again, like final projects at the end of the year. But for the most part, I'd say it was very manageable compared to last year. I had so much homework. I probably had like an hour of homework for each class, and I had 6 classes last year. So that was just like a lot. And I'd get very overwhelmed, very stressed. And like everything was always just very, like just overwhelming. And this year it was very manageable. And it was just really easy to get my work done, like stay on task and stuff.
Great. Thank you, Sammy. Sharon, did you see, Diane, if you want to say.
I just wanted to add one thing, that they have office hours in the evenings, and I don't know what it's going to be like next year. So, but this year when they were on Zoom and Lulu would just hop on to office hours and I'd hear her upstairs like talking and laughing, and it was, whether she needed the extra help, it was almost moot. It was like she had this community that she could do her homework with from home. Mm-hmm. And that was awesome.
Great. Thank you. And Sharon, do you, just from speaking, just from kind of, you know, going from eighth grade into high school and just kind of, did you see them have a lot of homework? Or just kind of, you know, what was their ability?
I asked them in October. I was like, don't you have any homework? Because I didn't see them doing it. And they did do it mostly during the school day. Mm-hmm. So just, you know, echoing what Bridget and Sammy said, SAS is a wonderful place where, you know, it's a guided homework help. That really helped one of my daughters. And then the other one had enough free time during office hours or, you know, during some breaks that she could get most of her homework done, if not all of it, on a regular day. Also, I don't know, the students would know more about this than me, but the class time is long. So I think a lot of the work is done in class, actually, that in other schools might be brought home.
Yeah, I was gonna mention that. I almost every single one of my teachers would give at least like 10 to 20 minutes at the end of class to just like get started on your homework. But yeah, that's helpful, definitely.
Mm-hmm. Great. Josh, you want to talk a little bit, like something that we offer is spring sessions that, you know, we didn't get to do it this year like we normally do, but do you want to talk a little bit about that? Because that's kind of a unique feature for spring in the springtime.
Yes, absolutely. And I think only Sophia of all the students here has actually done a spring session, because we didn't do it in 2020 and again in 21. So spring session is essentially a week-long mini course that we run in what would be our last week of school in the spring. So that's typically, our graduation is the Saturday after Memorial Day. So the week of Memorial Day, we run mini classes. And some of those take place on campus or short drives off campus. We'll go different places. And some of them are longer travel trips. We do a really wide variety of things. We did a trip called the Civil Rights Journey, where we had a group of about 15 or 18 students with three faculty chaperones go down to Selma, Alabama, and Birmingham and see some of the major sites of the civil rights movement. They did some work ahead of time. They came back. They did a short presentation. We do a presentation aspect for all of our spring sessions on the Friday before graduation as kind of a culminating exercise. And then we do other things. We have a mural. If you've been on campus, I know not everybody has had a chance, but in our boys' dorm, we have this beautiful mural in one of the stairwells that was made during one of our spring sessions. We have a fitness for life, essentially kind of spring session where students are guided through a lot of different fitness options, kind of lifetime stuff. I'm trying to think.
We were supposed to go to Madrid, right? Weren't you supposed to do a trip to Spain?
It was going to be in March, actually. It was going to be outside of the spring session window. Our travel is typically a little more, isn't international because the window isn't that big.
Right.
You know, but Sophia, what did you do as a sophomore? Do you remember?
Yeah, I painted the mural, actually.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Good. I'm glad I mentioned that.
It was fun. It was like, they called it an on-campus thing, which I thought meant like only on campus, but it was actually really cool because we took like little mini trips at the beginning of the day to like Jamaica Plain, all around Boston, and like actually like found murals to like gather like inspiration from. And it was like, I don't know, it was just a really fun time to just like hang out with their friends and like teachers who are leading the activity.
Great, thank you. There's another question. How are parents involved at CHCH? Either one of you want to talk about that? And then Christina, I can have you maybe talk about the PGA as well. Sharon, did you
I was going to talk about the PGA.
No, I wasn't
sure. A little bit, but.
So yes, no, that's great of you, but yes.
There is a parent guardian association that works. We have a contact actually in the administrative staff who helps us to organize. She's a liaison between the administration and the parents, but we have monthly meetings. It's a great way to meet other parents. Diane's also involved. There are some events that we get involved with, fundraising events, but this year, you know, because we couldn't do some of the things, we also had the parents got together and gave gifts to the faculty and staff for appreciation. So other things that aren't directly fundraising events. There's also coffee and conversation that someone else might be able to, you know, talk more about, but I think there were ideas that the parents raised or the administration, you know, talks given by faculty or outside experts to the parent community. And that was another great way that parents could get involved and have really helpful discussion as well.
Great. Thanks. All right, wonderful. Any last minute questions that I see? We're just coming upon 8 o'clock. You've all been wonderful. I know we've done a lot of these this past year, so great. And I just wanted to briefly mention next steps for the admissions process. So if any of you joining us this evening are currently in high school or going into high school in September, we are doing rolling admissions right now, which means we're just kind of, you know, we have limited spaces available and just kind of going through case by case. But we are doing on-campus tours and interviews, as well as virtual options if families aren't comfortable with that. And then we do have students sometimes who can come in to do the tour, like Sophia sometimes comes to campus during the summer to give a tour, Bridget. And, you know, so I think even though our school year's over, we try to give you the opportunity to get to know as much as you can. And, you know, the interview is part of the process, and it's, you know, really Christina and I do the interviews, and it's really just getting to know the student and just why they're looking at it, want to look at other options, what their interests are, what kind of school they're looking for. We talk about academics and just all sorts of things. So it kind of just really brings the application to life and just adds some character to it. Nothing to be nervous about. It's just really a conversation between us. And then we would meet with one or both of the parents after that. There is an application. So we do use either our own online application or the SAO, which is the standard application online, through the organization who runs the SSAT. There is a, you know, there's, you know, kind of outlining it really quick. There's, you know, the student application part, the parent application part, the biographical information. And then we do ask for some teacher recommendations. I know it's summertime and we ask you to do your best trying to get those. And if not, we just kind of work through that the best we can. Typically we ask for current math teacher, English teacher, and a school recommendation, as well as a transcript. And I mentioned earlier on for testing, if students have an IEP or a 504, we do, you know, look at a neuropsych test. But don't worry about having to take the SSAT at this point, because it's I'm not sure how readily available that would be. So Caroline here with us runs the tour guide program and sets up our calendar. So if anyone is interested in, you know, finding out more about our school and going through the application process, you know, you can certainly reach out to Caroline or any of us, and she can certainly walk you through that. So I just want to take a moment to really thank our panelists for your authenticity and your, you know, story sharing and just your experiences. And super proud of all of you. And just, you know, I think Josh and I have been here almost just as long as one another. And I think, you know, this is always, you know, a reminder for me of why I continue to work at CHCH, because of this community and the students and the transformation that we see them go through. It's really humbling and just, you know, just so great to see it. Just, I remember interviewing Sophia You know, and now she's going off to college and just being a part of that beginning of her journey. It's just really special to kind of see that. So thank you all for joining us and really appreciate that. We did record this. So we'll be sending out a push with the recording and also putting it on our website for any friends you might know that want to see it. Please feel free to pass that along. So again, thank you so much, everyone. Great job. And I hope everyone has a great night. Thanks, everyone. Bye.
Thank you.